The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Welcome to the webinar for the Ramsar Sites Information Service. This webinar is for National Focal Points and Ramsar Information Sheet compilers. It is intended to help you designate and update Ramsar sites by showing the different aspects of the system. My name is Manuel Kern. I am in charge of the technical IT-related matters of the RSIS. And with me today is Reiko Itsuka, the Senior Regional Advisor for the Asia-Oceania region, and Nikki Cromeri, the Intern Assistant to the Advisor for the Asia-Oceania region. Before we move on, I'd like to ask a warm-up question. You should see a poll coming up shortly. So the question is, what is the total area of all Ramsar sites globally? And you have got three answers. Please click on the one that you think is the correct one. Okay, I see answers coming in. Thank you. Good, the majority seems to know the exact answer. Yes, so the majority says it is 253,879,235 hectares, which is the correct answer. So thank you for participating. I'll close the poll now. And don't worry if you didn't know the answer after this webinar, you will know where to find this answer. So the program today, after a short presentation of the RSIS and an overview of the public part, the webinar will guide you through the back end of the system by broadcasting live the view of a user working with the system. Throughout the webinar, you'll have several occasions to get answers to your questions. The points listed here will be covered. They are the same as you received in your invitation. Some explanations how the webinar is going to happen, and so you can submit questions at any time during the webinar. In the GoToWebinar control panel that started when you joined the webinar, you'll find a box with the title Questions. Post your questions there. Please don't use the chat. Use this questions function. We will try to answer as many questions as possible. And all unanswered questions will be followed up by email after the event. So first, a short introduction about the Ramsar Sites Information Service in general. The RSIS, how we will call the system throughout this webinar, is divided into two separate parts. The first is the public part, where you find information about the sites of the Ramsar list. It is accessible for everyone, where you have the map view, you can use filters and search for Ramsar sites, and you can do exports, etc. Then there is the password protected area, which is for contracting parties in the secretariat to work with the sites, so to create new sites, to launch updates, and to review the sites. The Ramsar information sheet, which we will call RIS throughout this webinar, can be filled by the AA, which is the national focal point of the country, or compilers, which are consultants that are appointed by the AA. So this can be an NGO person or an academic. So this is the national focal point who can grant access to compilers. And important to know, it is always the national focal point who keeps control of the site. So only the focal point can launch a new site or launch an update. The compiler only can fill in information after the AA granted access to the site. So for us to get a sense of how familiar you are with the system, we will launch another poll, a short poll, to know how many of you have already logged into the system. You should see the poll coming up now. So have you already logged into the RSIS? Good, so it looks 50-50. Half of you know the system, half don't. Good, and almost no one tried without success. That's good to know. Thank you. So I'll close the poll now and move on with the presentation. So I'll now show you the system, the public portal in action. For this, I will change to the browser window. So this is the main entry point for the public. The web portal is to visualize and search for information about the Ramsar sites. It is available in three languages, see in the top right corner where you can change English, French, and Spanish. In the top left corner, you can see the number of sites and the area they cover. And this is where you would have found the answer to the first question that I was asking. There are three different views. Let's start with the map view, the one that loads by default. So this is a standard online map offering the same functionalities as other spatial portals you already know. You can pan, you can zoom, etc. Each orange dot represents a Ramsar site. They are the centroids. If you want to see the boundaries of a site, you can show them by selecting the polygons layer in this little layers box here. And where available, you will see the blue borders of Ramsar sites. You can also change the background layer. For this, you can go under the map. For example, you can use a satellite or street map. Then there is the list view. You can change the views by changing the tabs on top. In this view, you can see the same sites as in the map view with some information, some key information. The advantage of this view is that the sites can be sorted by for example, the area of the designation date. So if I want to know which one is the latest site that has been designated, I can click here. And I can see it is the one in Myanmar that has been designated a few days ago, actually. Then we have the statistics view on the stats tab. The first statistics shows the development of the site since the beginning with the number of sites and their surface. The second shows the site number and surface by region. And the third one shows the criteria, how the criteria are distributed. Now to the left, there are the search and the filter functions of the site. When applying a search or a filter, all the views that we've seen just now are adapted to only show the sites that correspond to the search. On the top, there is the global search field. It searches in many different fields of an RIS, like the official name, summary, species, country, or the threats. As an example, I will enter Numinius, which is the name of migratory birds. Hit enter. And if you go on the map, we can see only the orange dots where this bird is mentioned in the RIS. And the same, of course, in the list and in the statistics. You can open this little help here to get more information how to use the search functionality. If you want to filter by a specific field, use the filter boxes you can see down here. So if you, for example, want to know where in the region of Africa this bird is present, we can add this filter like this. And now we'll only see the sites in Africa where this bird is present. When I click on one of the orange dots or on the link in the list, there will be the details of a site shown. In the top left, you have some key information about the country, the area, etc. Where available, you will see pictures. There is always the summary to the right and this interactive map where you can see the boundaries and also surrounding sites. This map is interactive, so you can zoom in, zoom out, and have a look at the site like this. On the download section, there is always the latest information sheet available and the site map. They are both mandatory. And then there can be additional reports like other published literatures or whatever the country has uploaded for this particular site. I'll just open this latest information sheet. It is a PDF, and here there is all the information about this specific site in PDF form. Now let's have a look at the export functionality, and also here I would like to ask if you have already used this. I will start another poll because this is a functionality that is often where people often aren't aware that they exist, even though it is quite useful. And your answers confirm what I was just saying. Many people have never used, some sometimes, almost no one often. Good. Great. Thank you. So I'll close the poll now. So to create an export, you choose the format and enter email address. It's very simple. You can see down here, you can choose between Microsoft Excel, CSV, which is also readable by Microsoft Excel or any other spreadsheet application, or as a PDF form. And then you enter your email address here. The Microsoft Excel format is particularly useful to create any type of analysis. I will open one that I've downloaded previously. So you have key information like the site number, the name, region, country, the designation date, criteria, and the area, and so on. So from here, you can use the information to do whatever graphics you like to do, or pivot tables or whatever. The PDF format is a bit different. It contains either only most important information like designation date, etc., or you can optionally also choose to add the introductory text. And this is intended to have a pretty summary of the sites. It looks like this once you download. I made it here for Switzerland. So you have the key information on the top. Here I chose to have the introductory text as well, the annotated summary. So this is to have a pretty overview of all the sites. So for example, a country or whatever filter you have added. Good, I see that there are no questions so far. I invite you again to put your questions in the question box throughout the webinar whenever you want, and we will answer them during the webinar. So this was the part that is publicly available for everyone. Now we will switch to the part which is only for the focal points and compilers. So this part will cover how to create a new site or launch an update and includes explanations of your dashboard. Before switching back to the system, we will have a quick look at the RIS workflow. Here you can see that the site goes through three different levels, from the RIS compiler to the AA and then to the regional team. On each level, a site can be rejected, which means it goes back to the one that had submitted it. When a site is complete, the secretariat will process it for publication. You can find this workflow in the RSIS PDF tutorial, which is available on the RSIS and also on the RAMSAR website. I will now switch back to the browser so that you can see the system in action. For this webinar, the test system is used. The data you see here are a few weeks old. Before we go to the creation of a site and how to launch an update, I will talk about the dashboard. So this is the view that you will see when you log into the system as a focal point or as a compiler. Here you can find, first let's have a look at the Help tab, where you can find links to the available help resources like the written tutorial or the YouTube videos, the strategic framework, and also the offline word form. I'll go back to the existing sites. Here we have two lists. The first one is the pending RAMSAR sites. All the sites here are in the process of being designated or updated for your country. You have the RAMSAR site number, the name, the type, whether it's an update or a new site, the status. This is corresponds to what we've seen in the workflow just before. When it has been last modified, the country, and also who is the compiler for this particular site. The lower list is the list of designated sites, which contains all the current sites for your country that are published. The list contains the same information as above, but there's an additional column called quality, where you can see whether the site is up to date or out of date. A site that has not been updated within the last 6 years is considered out of date. On both lists, you can apply filters. You can search for a name or what I'm going to show here. For example, I only want to see all the lists that are submitted to regional teams. I apply and it will filter down to only the three ones that are submitted to the regional team. I'll now create a new Ramsar site in the system. Again, this is only visible for the ones that have national focal point roles. So if you're a compiler, you will not see this tab. You will have to ask the NFP to create the site and assign you as a compiler. So when I click on create a new site, I will come to this page where I first choose the country, the language I want for this site. And then I have to choose, do I want to have all of my compilers access to the site, yes or no? If I choose no, I will have the possibility to select one or more compilers in the box down here. So for this example, I will choose two of them. I'll give the name and I click on create new sites. And if I go back to my dashboard now, I can see, well, I have to remove the filter, and I'll see the new demo site, which is a new site that has just been created now, 27th of May. If in the box we saw before to choose compilers, a compiler is missing, send an email to rsisadmin@ramsar.org and we will create one for you. So this is how to create a new site. Now we will see how to launch an update. To launch an update, you choose the site in the designated sites list and all the sites that are available for update, you can see as an NFP again only, not as a compiler, you will see the action update. If there is only view, most likely the site has already been launched as an update, and then you cannot launch a second update. So I'll do it for this one. It's just as a confirmation I have to give. I say, yes, I want to update this site. And once again, it is in my pending sites list now, marked as an update from today. To choose the compilers, I click on Manage Compilers, and I will see a very similar interface to what we've seen before for the creation, where I can say who has access to this updated site. Good, thank you. I can see that there is a question that came in. I will let Reiko answer the question.
Okay, I received a question. The question is it possible to rename a site? Yes, it is. But we need an official letter from the AS to confirm.
Good, thank you. Are there any more questions in the list? Or is it... Good, so now that was the presentation for the public portal and the dashboard. Now we will move on to the online form. I will hand over to Nick, who will show you how this works.
Okay, thank you, Manu. After a new site has been created or an update of an existing site has been opened, the RIS compiler should now add the new or updated information of the site to the different sections of the online RIS form. In order to do so, first log into the system on the Manage My Sites tab. Here we go. And go into edit. Once logged in, you'll be guided to the home page of the online RIS form, which gives background information of the online RIS, the designation process, how to compile the RIS, and what if your information is missing. Please go through this information if you are unfamiliar with how to update or create a new RIS. The RIS form is made up of six different sections: the summary of the site, data and location, why the site is important, what the site is like, how the site is managed, and additional material. Now I will briefly explain each of these sections and what data should be provided within each. Firstly, the summary. The summary of the site should include details about the site's geography, its importance, for example, the reasons for designating the wetland as a site of international importance, the species composition, for example, whether it supports globally or nationally threatened species, and the importance of the site for people and community. We recommend you complete this section at the end of the RIS, as you will have a better understanding of the most important factors for the site. Moving on to the data and location section. Before I speak about this section, it is important to note that there are several mandatory fields within the RIS, which will require information to be provided. Otherwise you will have these red warnings, which will be projected onto the top of the page of the system, and you will not be allowed to submit the RIS to the regional teams. These particular sections are the RIS compiler's name and contact details, the GIS boundary, the digital map of the site, the official area, the criteria and their justifications, and at least one photograph. Please also remember to save pages as you move between sections. Moving on, under the data and location section, information has to be provided, such as the name and contact details of the compilers. This is particularly important as it allows us to get in contact with the compilers if any problems should arise. Further, we have the period of collection for the data and information used to compile the RIS. If data was collected both in the field and online between, for example, 2016 and 2018, you will add in this information into these sections. Next is the name of the Ramsar site, the official name. This should match the name at the top of the RIS, and also it should match the designation letter at the end. There are two extra sections within 2.1. These will only be provided with updates. They are section 2.1.4, which relates to changes to the site boundary, and 2.1.5, which are changes to the ecological character of the site. Next, we have the site location. This is where you're required to submit a GIS boundary of the site. Here's where you submit a GIS shapefile using the browse function. And you can use the help button, which is these question mark buttons here, which will provide information on what shape files are required to be submitted. Next, you can also, here is the digital map of the site, and this is where you can edit the map manually using the start editing site, and you can draw in the boundaries. However, if you have already updated a shapefile, this will automatically be uploaded into the system. Next, another mandatory section is the digital map. I have an example of a digital map here. A digital map, there are a number of mandatory requirements for the digital map. Firstly, the title should have the official Ramsar site name within it. The map should also have the GIS coordinates, the geographic coordinates, around surrounding the boundary of the site or the boundary of the map. There should be a clear boundary around the site. There should also be a legend, which includes a scale and a north arrow. And although it is not mandatory, it is helpful to have any geographic features or land use types surrounding the site. Further within this section are the boundary description, general location, we also have the area of the site, which is also a mandatory field. And for the official area, the area should match or be within 3% of the hectares which have been calculated in the digital map. Currently, it is within 3%, but if I change this, you will see that there is a red warning that indicates there is a change in the area calculated. Finally, at the end of this section is the biogeography, and you can select a number of drop-down menus, a number of options from the drop-down menu. As mentioned before, if you need any help at any point while filling in the RIS form, please click these help icons, which are located on the right side of most sections and subsections. Further details can also be found within the strategic framework, which is located within these help, icons. And this is the strategic framework. We regularly At the Secretariat, we regularly refer to this. The next section is why the site is important. This includes the criteria for identifying the site as internationally important. Please select the relevant criteria that justify the site's international importance and provide justification for each criteria. For instance, if I select criterion 1 and criterion 2 and save, we will get a number of red warnings which ask us to provide justification for these selections. Some justification will be required within other sections. However, there are some criterion which you supply the justification in the box below the criterion itself. I'll now display how to introduce an animal or plant species into the RIS in sections 3.2 and 3.3. Here I have already added a plant species, and as it is a threatened species, it is designated under criterion 2. I'll show you how to add a species. Here I have added an animal species, and a number of columns have been automatically updated. The IUCN red list has been updated and indicates it is an endangered species, as well as the CITES Appendix 1. So therefore we know it will adhere to the criterion 2. If I click another criterion, if to save these animal species, you need to save at the end of the row. If I click save, It will ask for a justification under criterion 4, which can be provided in the justification box within each row of each species. If you need further guidance on what information is required for a species to be uploaded, please click on the help button below the species box. This section will provide much more specific information on what is required for a species to qualify under a particular criterion. You can see the information here. Moving on to 3.4, ecological communities. Ecological communities whose relevance relates to the international importance of the site. Here you would include any noteworthy ecological community whose presence relates to the importance of the wetland. If a community is threatened and so qualifies under criterion 2, please justify why this is the case in the box justification and provide a description of the ecological community. Moving on, I'll go to section 4, what is the site like? Section 4.1 is the ecological character. Here you provide a summary of the ecological character, and specific things we're looking for include critical biological or physical components, its ecosystem services, and the ecological processes. Next is the wetland types. According to the wetland classification system of the convention, you can choose a wetland type that relates to the site. And this is found in Appendix B of the strategic framework. Also within Appendix E of the strategic framework are guidelines for identifying and designating specific wetland types. In this section, we are looking for parties to list all the wetland types of the Ramsar site, their approximate area if this information is available, and the ranking from the greatest to the least extent. Please note that this ranking found here only goes from 1 to 4. Finally, if the site classifies for criterion 1, this is the section where you provide a justification. Using the drop-down menu at the end of the table, you can select representative, rare, or unique. And again, you save at the end of the row. Further within this section, you're required to list any noteworthy plants or animal species that do not relate to the international importance of the site. Please note that this section is not for general species lists. This type of information can be added within the additional material. For further guidance on what species to list in this section, please see the help icon at the end of the box. You can also provide any introduced or alien species present at the site. These are important as they may adversely affect the ecological character of the site. Further within section 4, you can provide information on the physical components and ecosystem services. Within the physical components, here we are looking for people to indicate the site's physical and chemical characteristics, for example, the climate, geomorphic setting, and soil type. While in the ecosystem services, this section helps to provide specific information on the benefits of the site to people and the environment. And there are a number of drop-down options that you can choose. The next section is how the site is managed. Here, information on the ownership of the site and who is responsible for the management is required. Here you can provide information on public or private ownership and whether it is within the Ramsar site or in the surrounding area. And the management authority, this is particularly important, as especially for new sites, as this is a letter will be sent to the management authority upon designation of a new site. The threats or responses section. In this section, we are looking for the factors that are actually or likely to be adversely affecting the ecological character of the site. I will provide an example. For example, if pollution is an issue at the site, we'll select, for example, industrial and military effluents. And here you can include the actual threat, the potential threat, and whether it is occurring within the site and also within surrounding areas. And here again, you save the line at the end of the row. Please also provide any legal conservation statuses of the site, whether they be globally based, nationally based, or non-statutory. Whether any conservation measures or management plans have been put in place for the site. And within the management planning, you can add in a web link to a management plan. You can also provide a PDF within the additional material. Planning for restoration. You can do similar here as to the management plan. And finally, for section 5, you can provide any details of monitoring which are currently or proposed to be undertaken at the site. Here, there are a number of drop-down options available. The final section of the RIS deals with the additional material. All references used in the compilation of the RIS should be listed under this section. We don't ask for a particular referencing style, however, please be consistent with whichever one you use. Additional reports and documents, such as taxonomic lists of plants and animals, management plans, and any other published literature can be included in this additional reports and documents. Next, as mentioned earlier, it is mandatory to upload at least one photograph of the site. We encourage you, however, to upload as many high quality photographs as are available for a couple of reasons. Firstly, it adds to the appeal of the site's webpage once it is published. And second, it gives readers a feel for what the site is like to visit. Finally, it is also mandatory that the designation letter of the site should be uploaded in this section. In some cases, you may not have the site designation letter available. However, in this case, please speak to the regional team as there may be copies archived at the secretariat or on other files. Once all the required data of the site has been provided in the RIS, the compiler can now submit the RIS to the AIA for validation using the Submit tab here. Go to the Submit page and see if there are any warnings, either mandatory or recommended. If this is the case, all mandatory warnings have to be addressed. This is how a mandatory warning will look in the submit page. It will be in this red text. Without warnings, it will simply be blank and there will be no red notifications. With all the warnings resolved, you can submit to the RIS to the AA. The AA then validates the data and submits the RIS to the regional team. In the case of the AA, this box here will say submit to the regional team. After the RIS is successfully submitted to the regional team, we will review the RIS and go on to validate the information by provided by the contracting party. At any point of the RIS, if the regional team feels that the information provided is insufficient, irrelevant, or more data is required, then we will make comments on those sections and send the RIS back to the AA for further action. This is how the RIS appears when it is sent back by the regional team with the comments. Those sections which have been commented on will have a comment icon on the right-hand side. Another way of looking at these comments is to go to the Submit tab, and you can see the unvalidated comments here. You can click on these comments and it will take you to where the comment has been made. In order to react to the comments, you can click on the comment. Please go through, address them within the text box or section, and respond to the comment by posting your own comment. For example, that you have updated the information. At this point, you will only be allowed to make changes to the sections where the regional team has commented. If you need to make changes to other sections apart from the ones which the regional team has commented, go to the section, click on the comment icon, and add a comment explaining what changes you have to make. The section will be then unlocked, and instead of being in yellow, will be in a light blue halo around the text box. If you then save and refresh the page, the section should be unlocked and you can make the necessary changes. With all the comments addressed and responded, send the RIS back to the regional team. The regional team further validates the data and, provided it is satisfied, publishes the new site or the updated site. This is how the online RIS functions. I will now introduce the final poll that we have. Okay, the poll has been launched. Please provide your answers. Thank you. Okay, thank you for your answers. I'll now close the poll. And we've just shared the poll results with you.
Good. Thank you very much, Nick, for this presentation. Meanwhile, there were some questions coming in. Please feel free to submit further questions. We will have a little more time at the end of the webinar. I will just answer one, and then my colleague will answer another one, and the rest will be answered at the end. One question came in that says, what happens if we have uploaded a map, but the boundary that is shown is not the actual boundary? So when you upload a GIS file to the system, it will be converted into the format that we are using. And during this conversion, sometimes slight differences can appear. So if it's only a very small difference, if the boundary is, let's say, shifted a few meters to the left, to the right, or something like this, then it is most probably due to a conversion error. The best is to go into your GIS-enabled program, whether it's ArcGIS or whatever you're using, use the format that we are suggesting in the help box, and upload it again. If still the shape should be different, or let's say even if it's significantly different to what you were expecting, you can always send the map to the regional teams, and then we will check where the problem lies and help you with this. You can always use the widget that Nick showed before to adapt the boundary. If there's, let's say, just on one corner it is a little bit off or something, you can adapt the boundary. So now another question for Robert.
Okay, so we have a question on what to do if the system does not recognize a species name. This happens when the species name is not in the catalog of life, which is the current system that we use to fill our species list. In the case that you cannot add the species on the list, we ask you to add it on the optional additional information box that there it's below the list. So you can add the species by hand there and add why, if any criterion of international importance related to this species in concrete, and instead of adding it to the list, and that would be the solution that we have currently.
I would just like to add to this that we are currently looking into other databases to complete the list of species, because it is a problem that appears regularly that some particular species do not appear in a catalog of life. So we are exploring other solutions, and we have maybe identified something that will help, and it will most likely be implemented in the second half of this year. So normally soon more species should be available. Good, so there are still a few questions left that we will answer at the end of the webinar, because now I will say a few words on the offline forum. So the offline RIS word forum helps the AA and compilers to collect data without an internet connection or seek input from different local compilers working offline, while keeping control of the final content to be entered into the online RIS. So let's suppose the AA wants an external person to complete the data for a site. This person would then go to the dashboard that we've seen before, open a site. I chose one here that has already quite a lot of information in there. And then on the export tab, you can find Word exports. If there are comments, the system will ask you if you want to include those comments in your export. For this demonstration, I will say yes, and then I have to click on this link. Now the system in the background generates the Word export. This takes a few seconds, and when it's ready, it will be prompted for download. I will now open it directly in my Microsoft Word. And it is an editable file with all the information that has already been filled into the online forum is now available here. including the comments that have been added by the secretariat and the answers that have been provided by a compiler or by the AA. And as of here, you can organize yourself as you wish. One way of using it would, for example, be to activate the track changes in Word and then receive the information back from the external person. It is important to note that the information gathered with this offline form has to be input again into the online form and submitted through the RIS as any other online site. The secretariat does not accept submission of the offline Word form. It has to go through the system. Good, that was the whole presentation part. Now we'll go to question and answers. Let's give us a few seconds to see what has come in and how we're going to address those questions.
Okay, I just have a question here. Is it possible to add current information to an existing site, and what data can be added? Well, in this case, you can definitely add information to an existing site. It will occur as an update. We suggest you update the sites regularly at regular intervals, every 6 years. I wouldn't update a site if you had a small amount of information after it had already been published, for example, a year earlier. But if you have an extensive amount of data for an update, please go through the update process by having the administrative authority launch an update. And there is another similar question. How long is the period for the information to be considered out of date? And as I mentioned, after 6 years, most information within an RIS is considered to be out of date. However, long-term studies such as like annual shorebird or water bird counts, this information is very valuable. So please include this as well.
Good, thanks. I'll take the next one, which says, hello, can you please inform later about how do I become a compiler with access to the edit process? So the process is that first you need to be added as a compiler to the system. And for this, the national focal point of your country has to send an email to rsisadmin@romso.org. We will then, we'll including your name, first name, last name, and your email, and of the compiler, and we will create this compiler account and send directly information about how to log into the system to the compiler and inform the NFP that this has been done. Then the NFP has to assign the compiler, the newly added compiler, to the sites where this compiler has to have access to. If it's a new site, it can be chosen directly in the box that you've seen when I was showing how to create a new site. Or if the site's already in the process of being updated, there is the menu entry manage compilers where the newly added compiler can be assigned to a site. So first, to summarize, a new compiler account has to be created. And then second, the NFP has to grant access to the site that this compiler should have access to.
Okay, the next question is there a template for the designation letter? Is this mandatory? Unfortunately for our side, we don't have a template for designation letter. So it's up to your government how to prepare. And also this is a mandatory. So to prepare the designation letter, I would like to encourage you to look at the help section under the 6.1 in the RSIS.
I have another one. If you have the online form completed, do you have to enter data manually to the online form? The answer is yes. Once you have collected information in Word, you have to copy them over into the online form. There is no automatic import from the Word offline form into the system. So this would be a copy-paste process.
Sorry, there seems to be, okay, sorry, there was a problem with the audio. So we have a question which says, can you please sum up the process of editing comments, acceptation, and resend? So to summarize, basically when the
We're sorry, Robert is having difficulties with his headset.
Okay, Robert is just having some difficulties with his mic, so we'll just get back to that question. Robert may in fact email the asker of that question. I have another one, how to get authority to update a site. Well, if you are a compiler or if you are an NFP, you have the authority to update a site. You should have the access. And if not, you can speak to the IT department here at the Secretariat, where you should be able to get authority to create a new update. If you're a compiler and have new information, get in contact with your NFP, where they will be able to create an update of a site.
Okay, we'll try again with Roberts.
Apologies for the technical troubles. So again, to summarize the submission process of an RIS, so basically it's the AA and the compilers compile the information on update or new site, then this information is sent through the, is submitted to the regional team, which then we then provide some comments, as you, Nick, showed you before, it shows in yellow, which should be addressed, then we send it back to you, back to the administrative authority. Then the administrative authority and the compiler address these comments and then sends back to the regional team. And once the regional team feels that it's ready for publication, we submit it for further review within the Secretariat, and then finally with the publication of, with the documentation officer for publication.
Good, so the next one is, can I get the material from the presentation section? Yes, of course. So first, the whole webinar is recorded, and it will be, you will receive a link after the webinar to the video, and the video will also be posted to the website as well as the presentation section. Another one is, in the RIS, why does some sites have update and some have view? Does it mean that the sites have that have view have not been out of date yet? So I think you are talking about the designation part of the designated sites list part in the dashboard, where you can sometimes have the update action and sometimes you don't. It is not related to the out of to the state of the site. It is related to whether an update has already been launched for this particular site. So once you launch an update from one of the designated sites, it will, there will be a copy of the site in the sites that are currently being processed, and you cannot launch a second update for the same site, because this would be really confusing to have several parallel updates. An update can only be pending for a site once. So when you don't see the update action, it means that the site already has been launched an update and it is already in the upper list.
This is not a question, more so a remark. From the poll, a lot of people seem to have most problems with criteria. Please note that there is considerable information within the strategic framework about the criteria and the interpretation and application of the criteria. So please look for the strategic framework within the links, which are in those question icons which are associated with most of the RIS sections. Thanks.
Okay, so there are still one or two more questions, but I see that it is already 11, so we will follow up with those questions bilaterally with the one that has asked it. Thank you very much for your time. We hope that this webinar was helpful for you. And the regional teams are always available in case you have further questions. So as I said before, this webinar has been recorded. And there will be a link to the whole video file. So this answers actually one of the questions that is still pending. It will be a real video where you can hear also the questions and the answers to the questions. It's not only the presentation. We wish you a very nice day. Thank you for your attention. Goodbye.